and welcome back to Bumblebee. Today's list has the wedding bells chiming. The top 10 ways marriage was different in medieval times. All right, so you guys know my drill, so let's start off with the information most people may know a little bit more about already, such as dowries, which is a nice way for fathers to say, I will literally pay your family to get this chick out of my house. The arrangement of marriage was done by the bride and groom's parents. Royal or noblemen were sometimes able to choose their bride, but marriage back then was not based on love for the nobility, they were political arrangements. Husbands and wives were generally strangers until they first met, and if love was ever involved, it came after the couple had been married. But even if it didn't, most just sort of settled into a form of friendship or companionship, or just living with each other. The arrangement of marriage was based on monetary worth. Noble girls equal fatter stacks. Meanwhile, peasant dowries didn't really happen often, and when they did, they were paid in utilitarian means. The family of a girl who was to be married would give a dowry to the family of the boy she was to marry. After the marriage was arranged, the wedding notice was posted up on the doors of the church, and the notice was put up to ensure that there were no grounds for prohibiting the marriage by stating who was to be married and if anyone knew any reasons why they could not. But more on that in a little bit. Now, as mentioned, peasants were able to marry for love, but why make that choice? There was no marital benefits back then. Because it's marriage or burn in damnation. Throughout the Middle Ages, the church essentially presented women with two life options in order to escape the sin of Eve. You could become celibate, which ultimately was the preferred choice, or to become married and mothers. You don't bathe, there's feces everywhere, there's the plague, and a man could just kill you tomorrow for rejecting him, and you want to add kids to that equation? When there's no medicine either? Pass. Hard pass. Nunneries were literal havens for these single women, because sure, you could be celibate and still live in town being a spinner or whatever, but again, you run the risk of some dude just jumping you and the courts blaming you for it and then doing something whack like cutting your nose off for it. Nunneries were female only, they kept things clean and locked up, so women could just try and have an ounce of peace in an era where existence was just to breed or feel bad about yourself. According to Halston C.S., once a girl was physically ready to consummate, aka she met Aunt Flo, she was ready for marriage. However, since puberty came earlier for females than males, they could marry at a younger age. So, for peasants who were genuinely interested in marriage out of love, something that could only be done consensually on both sides, they were eligible once they'd hit their respective puberties. And were able to wed. No parental consent required, which is the next on the list. As people lived short lives in the Middle Age period, parents of nobility often made arrangements early on, and a few months old baby could be betrothed to another few months old baby, and then raised in their respective royal nurseries until they hit that jolly old consummation age in their teens. Think Sleeping Beauty being promised to the prince in the Disney movie. Peasants and commoners, however, were able to marry as they wished, and parental consent wasn't even required. It was like this for centuries. But there's always those folks who didn't like when two separate religions mixed, and there's always those who tried to take advantage of the easy I do policy. So good things never last, and it didn't. When this law finally changed in England in the 18th century, the old rules still applied in Scotland, making towns just over the border, such as Gretna Green, a destination for English couples defying their family and wanting to marry without their consent. A brief personal story for you guys. So, my mother is a traveler and decided to visit the famous Gretna Green town and wedding site, where the tradition of Gretna Green marriages still lives today. My mother was taking photos and reading history plaques when she got taken aside by her tour guide. A couple whose family wasn't supportive of their relationship, just like the couples of the past, had shown up and decided to marry spontaneously in the traditional way. They had chosen Gretna Green for its historical significance to their unsupported love, and they needed two witnesses. The tour guide could act as one witness, but they needed a second. So my mother stood as a witness for a young couple who had just traveled to the border to marry at Gretna Green alone, experiencing the same pilgrimage thousands of couples had done in history. So on the topic of witnesses, how did that get started? Up next is witness schmittness. In the Middle Ages, the household was headed by a husband, and his wife was the center of the family life and economic productivity. As John Wellis said in 1486, more things are necessary for a household than four naked thighs. And he used this retort upon hearing that his alleged betrothed, Alice Billingham, had publicly declared they were married. Instead of saying it straight, John was chastising Alice for suggesting they could legitimize their romantic relationship without the necessary social status and financial stability, not just intercourse. Alice, however, goes, nah, bro, I got the receipts, which were her witnesses to the fact that John had asked her to be his wife on the Feast of St. Valentine's that same year, which historically, yes, has always been a romance hallmark holiday. Asking begging her for her hand so that she could be his Valentine forever. These two contrasting stories, however, give us a peephole into the tension between the expectation of love versus intercourse, and then the making of a good and economically fortuitous marriage in the Middle Ages. Alice says, "You proposed to me with love, therefore that is our marriage basis." John says, "I may have said I loved you, but I won't make a wife out of a..." Well, you get it. So, while God was the ultimate witness, that's why couples could just say stuff like, "be mine forever" and become legally married. It's nice and all, but it was highly recommended to have witnesses to avoid uncertainty like the Alice and John situation. Because they didn't just sign your wedding doc back then, they stopped your husband from wandering off. I've done a lot of talk on the ins and outs of marriage, but how about kiss to be kissed, the medieval wedding ceremony itself? So, there was some errands to run leading up to the big day. First of all, long before the actual wedding, bands were called, which were literally 3 Sundays leading up. Someone stands outside the church and hollers that your wedding day is coming up. It's done so that people can come find out about the celebration and come along to the wedding. But also, those who had objections had the opportunity to voice them. They also put up signs on the church door with information, so if you're out just buying turnips one day and saw your husband's name and face on a poster, you could go up to the medieval lost and found and say, "Hey, yo, this one's mine. Wedding's off." A wedding ceremony could not be held on a Catholic holiday or on Sundays. A couple could not be married during a time of fasting. They can't be married by someone who had killed someone else. So make sure you got all those things written down to avoid. When weddings started to occur at churches, they were done at the front doors. Nobles married with big parades and elaborate garbs, while peasants sort of kicked it in whatever they had. The couple would exchange vows, usually some Jesus-y stuff, and the priests asked one last time if anybody's got any beef with these two getting hitched. After that, the groom presented his bride with a wedding ring, blessed by the priest, and the ring was placed on each finger of the bride before landing on the ring finger, and amen, the ring stays there. Then the procession goes into the church, a special mass began, and people prayed for the couple and their future offspring. After the mass, the priest kissed the groom on both cheeks, and finally, the groom would kiss the bride. But sometimes you can say "I do" and have a whole ceremony and still have to prove it. In the Middle Ages, getting married was easy for Christians living in Western Europe. According to the church, which created and enforced marriage law, couples didn't need permission of their families or priests to officiate until towards the end of the 18th century. And though the church controlled, or tried to control, marriage, couples didn't need to marry in a church until the 18th century. So, medieval legal records show people getting married on the road, down at the pub, at a friend's house, in bed, really anywhere. All that was required for a valid binding marriage was the consent of the two people involved. So, while tying the knot can take a matter of moments, proving you were married is a different story. The vast majority of marriage cases that came up before the courts were to enforce or prove that a marriage had been taken place in the first place. And marriage mix-ups bothered the clergy since, after much debate, theologians decided in the 12th century that marriage was a holy sacrament. The union of man and woman in marriage and intercourse represented the union of Christ in the church, and this was hardly symbolism to be taken lightly now. So they wrote up some laws and dished them out. The statutes issued by the English church in 1217 to 1219 include warnings such as, "No man should place a ring of reeds or another material, vile or precious, on the young woman's hands in jest, so that he might more easily fornicate with them. Lest he thinks himself to be joking, he pledge himself to the burden of matrimony." Another thing in those statutes was, "Hold that peace." Not your pee though, I know it sounded similar, but you can do that on the streets anywhere, it's medieval times. Beautiful. Anywho, the bonds I mentioned earlier were introduced as part of the 1215 changes to try and flush out any impediments before a marriage took place. This could be someone is already married, or she's not a virgin, or he's wanted for killing someone. There's range. Nevertheless, until the Reformation, there was no speak now or forever hold your peace. In the Middle Ages, problems discovered or revealed after marriage could have an enormous impact still. For example, Joan of Kent, who's remembered as Edward the Black Prince's wife and the mother of the future King Richard II, was married in her early teens. It was a whole Diana level spectacle with full publicity, a church service, her new boo was an aristocrat. But after about 8 years of marriage, this marriage was overturned in the papal court, and she was returned to a knight she had secretly married without her family's knowledge or approval when she was 12. Imagine that, spend 8 years with a dude only to be shipped back to some idiot I said I love you to to when you were 12. If that still happened nowadays, we'd all be locked in with our first crushes. Take a minute, please, and soak that horrible thought in. Anyways, it's difficult to know how many medieval people married for love or found love in their arranged marriage. There was certainly a distinction between free consent to marry and having a completely free choice. Now, circling back to my earlier point where I explained the wedding day, how about the wedding night? Not a moment alone is next. All right, y'all have officially tied the knot and locked lips for the first time. You did some praying, now it's time for a meal. Pretty normal stuff that lines up with nowadays. The peasant couple celebrated with their friends and family, drinking bridal ale for this special occasion and eating a meal traditionally made up of dishes brought by the wedding guests to help feed the community. That's right, y'all, like a trailer park wedding, medieval receptions were potlucks. After the reception, a peasant couple may dance and enjoy their night, but a royal couple is ushered to the chamber to consummate the marriage in bed ASAP. The priest, the clergy, parents, really whoever wanted in on the action would come into the room, kick their feet up, and have some popcorn and tell the couple, give us a show here. The bride needed to be a virgin at the time too, which had to be proven by blood being on the bed sheets. If there wasn't any, the whole wedding could be undone on the spot, which actually would be really hard for those women who don't bleed their first times. They do exist. And of course, because there isn't enough people in the room while your cherry's getting popped as is, a medieval wedding tradition allowed unmarried guests from the procession to also follow royal newlyweds into the room and take turns throwing the bride and groom stockings at them. Whoever managed to make a direct hit would presumably get married soon. Yeah, this is where the bouquet toss comes from. Then someone has to go retrieve it off the naked sweaty couple so someone else can have a throw. Truly a magical time of wedding traditions. Imposed witnesses, parental consent, church weddings. Yes, it was because of the confusing I do issue and a bunch of others I've listed, but it was also because of kidnap. So, over the last 20 years, historians have increasingly problematized consent we've heard of in the past, warning us not to project modern understanding of consent onto that medieval canon law. Today, consent is defined by what is present instead of what is absent. Yes means yes instead of no means no. In medieval times, the gap between coercion and consent was essentially a hairline. Women didn't have many legal options to deal with very persuasive or dangerous men who demanded their hand and would stop at nothing to achieve it. And consequently, the women often agreed to marry them for fear of their life. Because stopping at nothing often led to being captured. And with women being property, if said captor managed to return home and take the woman against her will before a brother, father, knight, whoever can do something about it, she becomes his property. These abductions then regularly end in marriage because of the damage of the deflowering caused to the victim's reputation. She'd never be wanted by anyone else, and so the POS who can't understand the word no wins. To delineate between consent and coercion, canon laws dropped in the 1200s stated that the degree of pressure applied on an individual could not sway a constant man or woman, meaning that neither family members, romantic partner, a stranger, anyone could exert pressure on an individual to force their consent. However, the degree to which force is interpreted and is defined by each city or community. Some communities stay stuck in old ways. And last but never the least is apparently you can be two into your wife. So, marriage aside from being a means of property exchange was also used by the church to regulate adult activities and carnal desires of the everyday person. Because any intercourse outside of marriage was a universal sin, but intercourse in marriage is only acceptable for procreation. Which means the church is trying to peddle that a good intimacy relationship was beneficial to your marriage, but neither desire nor pleasure should be involved or play a role in it. Because that's physically possible. They took this serious too, man. Like, Thomas Aquinas warned that a man who slept with his wife solely for pleasure was treating her like a lady of the night. And Saint Jerome stated in the 4th century that a man who is too passionately in love with his wife is an adulterer. This is a sentiment which remained prevalent up until the end of the 16th century. Not only was the purpose of intercourse within marriage made abundantly clear by the church, and still is, but there were many rules and regulations pertaining to the act itself. Like when the activity between the husband or wife was or wasn't permitted. That would be like a feast or fast day, Sundays, menstruation or pregnancy, while breastfeeding, and for 40 days after childbirth, also holidays, and holy days. This meant that on average, most married couples could legally have intercourse less than once a week. Negative one time a week, you guys. But at least we had champs like Albert the Great, who would throw ladies the proverbial bone every now and then. He defended women's carnal desires during pregnancy, actually, in a document, claiming that the fetus stimulated desire in women. A woman never desires relations so much as she does when she is pregnant. Medicine is most needed in the time of greatest illness. That's a hell of a sentence, a lot to unpack there, so let's just leave it as medieval marriage sucked. Alright, my regals and rumblers, I hope you enjoyed, and be sure to give us a like and subscribe if you did. As a wedding planner, I'd be remiss not to ask, tell me about your favorite or your culture's wedding traditions below, and how they may have changed over time.